Hey, let's do some grade 12 applied, more practice, more warm-up. Mainly design and measurement. Let's look at how balloons work and, you know, patios, if you were to build a patio, and maybe you're going to make a trail mix company. All right, so maybe you're going to make some trail mix. So knowing how to do these types of calculations might be kind of important if you're ever going to fix up your backyard or blow up balloons for a birthday party or go into business making trail mix. There you go. So redo. So there was the first two questions, straight out of the workbook. And here's the final question. All right, so copy them out, do it, then get back to me. Copy it out, do it, pause. Are you ready for the answers? Here we go. So, of course, you know the first thing we're going to do, right? We're going to draw something. You're going to take all that gobbledygook and draw a picture. So I drew a ball. It's pretty easy to draw a ball. Draw the equator on there, too. If you put, like, the equator on, it turns it into three dimensions. And usually you can't see the equator in the back, so I make those dashed lines. Witness lines are called. All right, so here we've got a balloon. It's got a diameter all the way across through the center of 30 centimeters. And then somebody adds more air into it. So somebody says, oh, that's not big enough. Make it bigger. Add an extra 500 square centimeters. And you go, what? What does she mean? Add an extra 500 square centimeters? So you got to increase the surface area of the ball by 500 square centimeters. So the question is, what's the new diameter? Then it's not an easy question. So after adding 500 square centimeters, because the person running the birthday party says, I want the ball to be bigger. So, well, in order to figure out what the new surface area is, you're going to have to figure out the original surface area. So the original surface area, it was originally 30 centimeters, and then they made you make it bigger. So let's calculate that surface area. So, you know, the volume, correction, you know, the surface area, not the volume, the surface area of a sphere is 4 pi r squared. All right, so look it up if you don't know that. Right, you'll always be given the formulas. Uh-oh, look at that. Trick. Look, R. The R is 15. This is why you write out the formula. As you're writing out the formula, you realize that the formula requires an R. So that twigs you to go tweak up your diagram and go, uh-huh, you can't fool me. A 30-centimeter diameter is a 15-centimeter radius. There you go. So that is why you draw a picture. That is why you write down the general formula before you plug in the numbers. Now you plug in the numbers, and you get that the surface area of that ball, if you were to cover it in little 1-centimeter squares, right, there'd be 2,827 and a bit square centimeters on the outside of that ball. But then, of course, you were told to make the balloon bigger. So you got to add an extra 500 square centimeters on the outside. So somehow you got to keep blowing it up a little bit more. So if you add another 500 square centimeters to make its surface a little bit bigger, doesn't that make the new surface area of your sphere to be, let's see, 3,327 and a bit square centimeters. All right, so there you go. So now you know the new ball has that extra surface area. But how big is it now? How wide is it? All right, so now we got to figure out what is its diameter. So let's figure out the new diameter. Determine the new. Notice how by writing out what it is you're doing using words, instead of just a flurry of numbers flung all over the place, by writing out what it is you're calculating in words and then keeping track of what's going on, it's certainly essential. All right, so let's determine the new diameter. So the surface area of the final balloon is, well, there's only one formula for surface area. You write it down, right? 4 pi r squared. Now you plug in the numbers. All right, so we're trying to find the r. So if we find the r, then we can double it, and that would tell us the new diameter. So let's find the r. All right, so You wrote down the formula. Now you plug in the numbers. You know what the surface area is. You know that 4 is 4. 4 has been 4 for a long time. You know that pi is pi. That hasn't changed in a couple billion years. It's the r that you don't know. Ah, so how do I get that r squared by itself? Well, I'm going to divide both sides by 4. And if I divide both sides by 4, they're still equal. So that cancels out the 4 on this side. And I'm going to divide by pi on both sides. Right? If I divide by pi on both sides, that gets rid of the pi on the right side. And it becomes a divide on the left side. You know, like it just pops underneath, right? Right? I don't like numbers that pop around. Now that leaves you with the r squared. So that's the r when you multiply it by itself. So the r squared is going to be the 332 and a bit. The r squared is going to be the 3,327 divided by the 4 times the pi. Right? Make sure this part's in brackets when you put it in the calculator. And you end up with 264.78 what? Radiuses squared, not radiuses. So now you've got to unsquare the radius. So how do you unsquare a square? That's called the square root. All right, so we want to unsquare the square. So if I unsquare the square on this side and I unsquare the square on this side, that will tell me the radius. So if I unsquare that, I end up with, 16.27 what centimeters? It's not centimeter squared anymore because I unsquared it. So now I know the radius is 16.27, but the question was, what's the diameter? Oh, so I got to double that. Oh, my goodness. So this was a little bit of work. Right? This might take you, this might take you 10 minutes. 16.27, this would be a good bonus question, wouldn't it? Right, so it turns out that if the radius is 16.27, then the diameter is 2 times that. So it's going to be 32.54. And teachers kind of like it when you write down the final answer. The new diameter is 32.5 centimeters. Don't forget to put units. A measurement without a unit is not a measurement. All right, so that was fun. Let's try another one. Okay, so even though this was from the design and measurement workbook, I threw in a perms and comms question in there, just to keep a little bit of practice. All right, so read and do. All right, do this. Pause it. All right, are you coming back now? Come on back. All right, so Rosalind wants to make a trail mix for a snack. She has 15 different ingredients to choose from. What is the total number of different trail mixes that Rosalind can create using 3, or maybe she'll use 4, or maybe she'll make a fancy one and use 5 different ingredients. And she's got 15 ingredients to choose from. What? All right, so I'm going to draw it. All right, so there you go. There's her pantry. There's all the stuff she has. All right, what has she got that she can select? She's got all these different choices for her trail mix. All right, she's got peanuts. She's got, what else has she got? Peanuts. Apples, raisins, pistachios, sunflowers, M&Ms. Oh, I love the M&Ms, right? So she's got all those 15 things to choose from. But she's only going to make 3, right? You don't want to make it too junky with 15 different things. So maybe she's going to make her trail mix using 3 ingredients. So you're not picking out the ingredients in a line, right? You're not picking them out in a line. You're actually just, the order in which you select your ingredients doesn't matter because they're just getting thrown into a package anyways. So she's just going to select 3 out of those 15 ingredients, and there's no particular order because when you throw them in a package, the order doesn't matter. So it's clearly a combo. There's 15 choices. She's going to make an unordered arrangement of 3 of them. She's going to make a group of 3 of them, a package of 3 of them. 15 combo 3 is 455 ways. So if she wanted to make a 3-ingredient trail mix using 15 possible ingredients but only throwing 3 in, there'd be 455 ways for her to design that. Oh my goodness, right? That's a lot of, you know, do I use the peanuts and raisins and pistachios, or do I use the dried apple, the M&Ms and the raisins, or maybe I'll use the peanuts and the sunflowers and the 455 decisions she has to make there. All right. Now she's not done. Maybe she'll use four ingredients. So guess what that's going to be? That'll be 15, combo four. She's got 15 choices. She's going to make unordered arrangements. She's going to package up four of them. That's going to be 1,365. Or she hasn't. Maybe she'll use five ingredients. So that'll be 15 combo five. Look at that. So it turns out she hasn't decided whether to make three or four or five ingredients in her trail mix. So what are all the choices she has to think about? Oh, my goodness. All right. This is, you know, if you're going to run a business like this, you probably got to be able to think like this. And there you go. She's got 4,823 different ways she might make her trail mix. Oh, man, that's a lot of choices to make. All right. So make sure you show all your steps, right? If all you got is a flurry of numbers all over the place, that doesn't work too well. Okay. Redo. And pause this. All right, come on back when you're done. So Cammy wants to build a circular cement patio with a diameter of 15 feet. And let's see, there's two parts to this. Cement costs $200 a cubic yard, and that includes taxes, thankfully. She's got a budget of $600 for the patio. All right, how many cubic feet can she afford? All right, so she's got a budget. How much cement can she afford? And, oh, part B is, so how deep is it going to be if she spends her entire budget? All right, so let's see. Let's do some math. All right, are you back with me? Here we go. Okay, so let's read it again here. So there it is. Pause, redo. All right, so I'm going to mark up the diagram. All right, so it's 15 feet across. So take whatever words you've got and add them to the diagram. And if there isn't a diagram, make a diagram. And we're going to make it a certain depth. All right, let's calculate how much cement she can afford. All right, so I hope you know that the cost of something is how much you buy times the price per unit. All right, so let's see. She can afford $600. All right, so that's going to be, how many units can she buy? So units being how much cement can she buy? So how many cubic feet of cement can she buy? Because we want to work things out in cubic feet. Uh-oh, but hold on, it's $200 per cubic yard. Notice that cubic feet and cubic yards aren't the same thing. You're going to have to convert. You got to make them the same. You can't mix units. You can't mix bananas and apples. So I'm going to convert the cubic yards into cubic feet because that's what we want. So I'll do a little side calculation here, all right? So 200 cubic yards, and I know that there's what? I know that the 1 yard is worth 3 feet. But guess what? That doesn't cancel cubic yards because that's only a foot. That's a length and that's a volume. So I've got to actually apply that conversion factor 3 times. Remember doing that back in grade 10? So it turns out if I do that, it works out to be $7.41 per square foot. All right, so a little side calculation there. So I know that the price, $200 a cubic foot, is the same as $7.41 a cubic. I'm sorry, $200 a cubic yard is the same as $7.41 a cubic foot. All right, I'll just draw it for you here very quickly. There you go. So if you don't know how to convert things, just draw them. All right, there you go. So there's a box. It's 1 cubic foot. And since a yard is the same as 3 feet, and this length is the same as 3 feet, and this length is the same as 3 feet, you got to convert all three edges into feet. You don't just convert one edge. So it turns out that 1 cubic yard is 27 cubic feet. There, I just proved it to you. I drew it to you. All right, there you go. So now you know she can afford 600, up to 600. We converted the $200 per cubic yard into $741 per cubic feet. Notice how we're now going to cancel out the cubic feet, so now we know what the money is. All right, so it's going to be, right, so we know that it's going to be 80.97 cubic feet. So she can afford 80.97 cubic feet of cement. There we go. All right, so now you go, so if I can afford that much cement, how thick is it going to be? How deep are we going to make it? Well, you know the volume of a cylinder. Look it up, pi r squared times h. So you write down the plain formula, just the letters. Don't plug in the numbers. Now you plug in the numbers. So you know that the volume you can afford is 80.97. Pi is pi. The R is 7.5. Don't forget, the R is half the diameter. That messes people up every time. This is why you draw diagrams and write down the letters. Don't forget to square it. Times the height or the depth. All right, so if I divide by the, if I get rid of the pi by dividing by pi, if I get rid of the 7.5 squared by dividing by it, guess what? Do the same thing to both sides, you're laughing. Now I know the depth. So the height or the depth is 0.458, what, pickles? No, 0.458 feet, because everything was in feet. Well, now they want the answer in inches. So now you got to look up in your old conversion tables. In the old days, we had a thing called feet and inches, right? So now you got to take the 0.458 feet and convert that into inches. And I hope you know maybe that there was 12 inches in a foot in the old days. So notice how the feet cancel out, and that converts it to inches. That's how you convert stuff. Here's the unit you got. Here's the unit you're trying to get rid of. So you put the feet in the bottom to cancel out the feet there, and it gives you the inches. We did the tons of this in grade 10 and 11. You can afford 5.5 inches deep of cement. Is that the answer? Or does that answer the question, rather? What is the maximum height of the patio? Yeah, so she can afford to buy up to 5.5 inches deep of cement. Woohoo! All right, and just to make it very clear one last time, people don't seem to understand that 27 cubic feet is the same as one cubic yard. Here you go, watch this. All right, there's a cubic yard, and if I make the edges in feet, 3 times 3 times 3 is 27. Right there. I just showed it to you in a diagram. All right, so when in doubt, draw it out. Or you could just convert it. You know, if you're going to convert it, make sure you convert all three edges. If you've got a cubic yard, you've got to apply the 3 feet per yard 3 times because there's a length and a width and a height. Anyway, there's the way we did it in grade 10. We did it in grade 11. We did it in grade 12 essential as well. All right, so it turns out that one cubic yard is 27 cubic feet. All right, so that was fun. Some of these take a little bit of work. They might take you 10 minutes. They might take you 15 minutes complete.